worship him this morning. Please stand and turn in your hymnals to number 29, This Is My Father's World, as we lift up our wonderful Savior. Number 29 is in all three verses. Being our creator, thank you for your matchless love display for us at Calvary, and for the privilege that each of us have to repent of our sin and receive the Lord Jesus Christ as the Savior, atoning for our sin. Lord, we thank you for this place and the privilege it's ours to gather in your house on this Lord's Day. We pray that you would be pleased with our singing, our time of tithes and offering. Lord, I pray most of all that we would allow your word to touch our hearts with the power of the Holy Spirit. Would you speak to us, Lord, directly today, personally, about our walk with thee. If there be any among us that don't know you as our personal Lord and Savior, we pray today they would trust you. For those of us who do, may we be drawn closer to you and closer fellowship and walk with thee. Bless again our time together, we ask, in Jesus' name and for his worthy sake. Amen. You may be seated and we will enjoy a special from our choir.
We will proclaim. Thank you, choir. Please stand. And we'll sing How Great Thou Art. About His wonderful goodness, His timeless hymn 801 in your hymnal, please.
Sure appreciate that. Always honored to have guests with us and honored to have the normal folk too. right? Whoever you think you might be, that's right. So, reminder, of course, tomorrow is the next Women of Wisdom meeting. That's at 1 p.m. at the Roaches home. And then this next week, Monday through Friday, is our VBS, Bethel Baptist School. It almost sounds like VBS. We're not having VBS this next week. That's a couple weeks out. But our school junior-senior trip, and so we'll be down in the North Lake Pigeon Forge area this next week. And so pray for our trip. The Lord will bless that. It's always a wonderful time. And, well, usually it's a wonderful time. We're hoping this will be as well. So look forward to that. Andrew and I will be leading that group. And then Tuesday is a primary voting day. And so we are a polling place here at Bethel. So the church office and school will both be closed that day. So just a reminder about that, and encourage you, if you have items to be voted on or matters to be voted on in your precinct, please get out and vote. And then, ladies, remember that the ladies' brunch is Saturday, May the 13th. That's just 2 weeks away, or thereabouts, and that the cost for that is $5. But you do need to get signed up for that. The sign-up sheet is on the bulletin board in the hallway. Also, we have a sign-up sheet for what is primarily the adult auditorium class, but we're going to open it up for all the church folk. They want to let some of you come too, all right? We're going to take a trip over to the Sight and Sound Theater in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, June 12th to the 14th. So it's Monday, Tuesday, and return on Wednesday. And so we'll be going over there in June. There's a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board for it. The cost for the ticket to see the drama, which is Moses. If you've not been to Sight and Sound, they do an excellent job. You can look them up online and see what they do. They do a fantastic job with these things. So we look forward to that. We'll see that. The cost for those tickets is $75. The church is going to take care of your transportation, but you'll be responsible for your meals and lodging. All right? So I can answer more questions for you if you have those after the service today. But you will need to get signed up, and the deadline to do so will be Sunday, May the 14th. Your $75 for your ticket, you can give that money to, or however many in your group, you need to give that money to Miss Kelly Wormel, who's right over here, right? My left-hand secretary, right? So you can give that to her. She'll take care of that for you. And we'll give you the information about where we're staying. If you want to book your own room there, you can do that, or I can book them together as a group. But that's an opportunity. We've been looking for an opportunity to be able to do something with our adult group. We've got a lot of things going on for our kids and such, and so here's an opportunity for families. If you want to bring your kids, you're welcome to. Obviously, they'll need to be appropriate age to be in the Sight and Sound and so on and so forth. We will eat well. For those of you that don't know, that is Amish country over there. We're going to eat well anyhow. It doesn't matter. We will eat well. It will be good. So hope you'll go with us. If you'd like to, the sign-up sheet is there on the bulletin board. Right? My dad, our Pastor Emeritus, will come receive our offering this morning. A
lot going on. Good things. And I hope that you can be a part of them. Let's have our ushers come. We'll honor the Lord with our tithes and offerings. Offerings? Well, I guess they are authorized, but offerings. Ethan, will you thank the Lord for the offering this morning?
Lord, thank you for the Sunday you've given us, that we can come and meet together in your house as your church body. I pray that we would worship you as you would see fit, and help us to receive a blessing from the message that Pastor has for us. Help us to make application of it in our lives. Pray that you'd be with the offering that we're about to partake of. Help us to give it as your lead, and help us to be able to support the ministries that we have and are doing so for your good. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Jesus needs my
Acts chapter 10. He certainly is. Jesus is enough. He's enough in the good times and the bad. He's ever faithful. Acts chapter 10. Before we read our text this morning, I want to ask you a question and kind of set the passage up for us a little bit today, if I can. But I want us to think about this thought. How do you see, or how do you view God? When you think of the Lord, what do you think of? You know, have you ever heard, or perhaps you've played or watched someone do this word association type game, right? Let me give you a for instance, right? Like if I said Buckeye. As you think something, you know, I think something, right? I could say, well, I better not say that other one. That might be bad. This is being live streamed, and I wouldn't want people to get the wrong idea about our ministry. But we could say Chevy. Or you could say Ford. You might say steak. Something comes to your mind. You have a thought that comes to your mind, that word association game. You think of something, and you know, it's a good thought or a bad thought, whatever the case might be. We tend to think a certain way about certain things, right? If you're a Buckeye fan and I say Michigan, ooh. Right? You know, by the way, ooh sounds a lot like blue, so thank you for that. And vice versa. But when you think of the Lord, what comes to mind? Wonderful? My question to you is, when I say the Lord, what's the first word that comes to your mind? And I know many of you are going, well, you just said wonderful. You think mighty, love, righteous judge, sacrifice, master. My point is this. We tend to think of the Lord relative to what our relationship with the Lord is at present. You might think, Almighty, He's just worked a miraculous event in my life where I've seen Him intervene. All-knowing, God knows all about me. He knows the wicked self that I am that other people don't see. Our relationship with the Lord is, we declare what that is by what we think of when we think of the Lord. What is the Lord mean to you? None of these terms we've described, wonderful or mighty, all-knowing, righteous judge, obviously none of them are wrong, but I think that our perspective of the Lord changes relative to where we are in our relationship with the Lord. Would you agree with me about that? And so as we look at this passage here this morning, I want us to think about this. Oftentimes our misunderstanding of God is because of our wrong view of Him, of our preconceived ideas about Him, or our self-will. You know, well, I want to do this, but God won't let me. So we're aggravated, we're frustrated with God. What is your view of the Lord? Let's notice here, if you would, please stand, if you're able, out of respect for the Scriptures. We'll look here at chapter 10, but let's read verses 1 through 8. You follow along, please, as I read Acts chapter 10. Verse 8, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian Band, a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, by the way, on the Jewish clock, that would have been about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, right, which was the time for their afternoon prayer, the Jews' afternoon prayer. He saw about the ninth hour of the day an angel of God coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, What is it, Lord? And he said unto him, Thy prayers and thine alms are come up for a memorial before God. And now send men to Joppa. Remember, we left Peter in Joppa last week. Send men to Joppa and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter. He lodgeth with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the seaside, and he shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do. By the way, we have evidence here that Peter enjoyed a beach ministry. Okay. I thought that'd be a little funnier than that. All right, okay. Where was I? I got distracted by the beach. Okay. Verse 7. When the angel which spake unto Cornelius was departed, he called two of his household servants and a devout soldier of them that waited on him continually. And when he had declared all these things unto them, he sent them to Joppa. I want to talk to you for a few minutes this morning about our view of the Lord. Father, help us, I pray, as we look into your word. Thank you that it's the everlasting, eternal truth. Thank you we can rest in your word. And Lord, I am grateful that I can preach authoritatively because your word is the everlasting truth. Help us to receive it as such. Holy Spirit, guide and direct us into the truth today. Speak to each of our hearts according to your will. Lord, I pray that our view of you would be accurate and that we would be growing in our relationship with thee. We ask these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Thank you for standing and be seated. So the first view I'd like us to see this morning is Cornelius' view. Cornelius' view of the Lord. We note, as we see here in the first couple of verses, his position. Cornelius was, his nationality was Italian, of Rome, and so he was a Roman centurion, the Bible says here. So that would mean that he commanded, he led, he had under his charge 100 military men. Right? So that would mean, we would justly assume, and it's more than an assumption, it really would be fact, that he was an accomplished military man. Right? They would not have given this authority and position to somebody who was not accountable. He would have obviously proven himself, no doubt, and perhaps in battle. He would have been a tough guy. He would have been a leader. You think about someone who stands tall and straight, and you know he's a centurion in the Roman army, and he's given charge and responsibility in this particular province here of Caesarea, and so this is who he is. So we see his position. He had great position, great authority, and we also note his pursuit. We see that in verse 2. Let's read that again. Would you follow there? A devout man. One that feared God, and with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. So he's not only devout in his pursuit of God, but he led his family to do so as well. All of his house, that I think that would have included his kinsfolk, but I think it also would have included his house. We know he had some servants, and he had other soldiers that would have waited on him. And so this is our household. As for me and my house, this is what we're going to do. Right? Now, he was seeking the Lord. We know, we see here that he doesn't know the Lord yet, but he's following the light that he's given. So his pursuit. First of all, he's devout. His heart was in the right place. He was devoted to understanding the Lord, and in his time, he knew, he understood, although he didn't agree with all the practices of the Jewish people, he understood that the Jewish people had a special relationship with God. So he's following in their practices, right? He was pursuing. He was devout in his heart. He was pursuing the Lord. The Bible tells us he gave alms. So he desired to please the Lord. In the Jewish economy, giving was a big part of their worship, right? If you study the Jewish economy out, they gave really three tithes, right? Let's see if I can get these correctly. One was for the government, one was for the temple, and then one was given as an offering, right? So wouldn't it be wonderful if our taxes were only 10%? But let's not get sidetracked, okay? Let's not go there. Okay, but nonetheless, giving was a big part of their worship. The Bible also tells us here that he prayed. And prayed to God always. What do you think that means? Well, let's describe the word prayed, first of all. It means to beg, to plead earnestly, to request. I draw from the scripture here, and I think you will agree with me, that this pursuit of God consumed Cornelius. Would you agree with me based on what the Bible tells us here? He was trying to figure this out. He was pursuing God. He was doing what he knew to do. He was giving alms. He was devout toward the Lord. I summarize Cornelius' life this way. He was following the light that he had while seeking more light to follow. He hadn't figured it all out yet. We know that. He's not saved yet. And some of you know what the rest of the chapter, he's going to get saved, right? I'll let the cat out of the bag. Most of us probably know that. He gets saved at the end of the chapter. Right? But he's following the light he has, seeking, pursuing more light to follow. The Bible says in the Gospel of John chapter 1 and verse 9, that, speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh and dwelt among us, that was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Cornelius took the light that he had and he was pursuing the Lord. He was pursuing God. His view of God was one, he didn't understand him yet, but he knew he was the light. He was following the best he could. He wanted to know more. All of us are given light. Romans chapter 1, verses 19 and 20, the Bible says this. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. God has created in every soul, in every human being, a conscience that bears witness to the fact that God is.
Amen. That's right.
What you do with the light you're given matters.
That's right.
What you do with the truth that you are given matters. Right? God gives the light. Cornelius was a man who followed the light he was given, and God gave him more light. He's yet another testimony, another illustration, another example in biblical history of someone pursuing God and God finding them. Or them finding God, however you want to say it. What are you doing with the truth that you have? The Bible also tells us, "You shall seek me and find me when you shall search for me with all your heart." You know, there are a lot of people that occupy good churches just like this one who don't want to know what God says.
That's right.
There are areas of our life, there are sections, there are pieces of our life where we go, God, you can have everything else, but don't mess with this. Right. What are you doing with the truth that you've been given? What are you doing with the truth that you have? Cornelius' view of the Lord was, he's there, I'm reaching for him, I'm trying to find him. And God came through for him. Here's what you need to do, Cornelius. You need to send some men to Joppa. Look for one Simon, whose surname is Peter. By the way, he's with another Simon. He's a tanner, and he's down there by the seaside. You go send for him. And what did Cornelius do? Yes, Lord.
Amen.
It's not recorded in the text, but that's what he did. His actions do speak louder than words. I believe the Bible. Great. How about you apply this passage here and obey this? Whoa, wait a minute, preacher. That's your idea. That's your preference. If we've got chapter and verse, I think we ought to obey.
Amen.
We ought to obey. Cornelius' view of the Lord. Secondly, this morning, I want us to consider Peter's view of the Lord. Look at me at verse 9. On the morrow, as they went on their journey. So Cornelius' men are on their way. It's about probably 20 to 30 miles, I believe, is the journey. It's about a day's journey, all right, on foot. So they're on their way. They went on their journey. They drew nigh unto the city. Peter went up on the housetop to pray about the sixth hour. So it's lunchtime the next day. Everybody with me? It's about noon the next day. Peter's up on the housetop on this beach house, right, overlooking the coast there, Mediterranean Sea. It's probably a beautiful spot. He's up there. He's waiting because he's hungry. Verse 10, he became very hungry and would have eaten, but while they made ready, he fell into a trance. And saw heaven open, and a certain vessel descending unto him, as it had been a great sheet knit at the four corners and let down to the earth, wherein were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, and wild beasts, and creeping things, and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." And the voice spake unto him again the second time, "What God hath cleansed, that call not thou common." This was done thrice. By the way, three is an important number in Peter's life. Remember, right? Three times the Lord told him this. And the vessel was received up again into heaven. Now, while Peter doubted in himself what this vision which he had seen should mean, behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate and called and asked whether Simon, which was surnamed Peter, were lodged there. Right? So we have Peter here. He begins with a self-focused view of the Lord's work. Right? So he's hungry, and that would be a normal thing. We're always hungry, aren't we? Are any of you like me that when we get done with a meal, I want to know what's next? I'm one of these crazy people that I eat my meal, and perhaps I call it my crib down the basement. It's a nice area. But anyway, I'm down there. I eat. I'll bring my plate back up to the kitchen. I'll set it down on the counter, and I'll go over to the pantry and open the door. And my poor wife, she's gotten used to it, so she doesn't take offense by it. But she looks at me like, "Did I not cook enough?" No, I'm just looking for what's next, right? We're always wanting to eat more, right? So Peter, he's hungry, all right? So he's hungry. He's up on a rooftop while they're making lunch, getting lunch ready. He's up there, and the Bible says he falls into a trance, all right? Now let's remember, church, so we got our brains in gear here. Remember, the book of Acts is a transition period in the Lord's dealing with mankind, right? So we're transitioning to the church age, and so there were many sign gifts and so on and so forth. If you have a bunch of pepperoni pizza this evening before you go to bed and you have a dream tonight, that's probably not a vision from the Lord. All right? So Peter's hungry. He has this vision. This obviously is from the Lord. Right? The Lord shows it to him three times. And so he begins with a self-focused view of the Lord's work. Notice this. He saw the Jews as clean and the Gentiles as unclean. We know from later in the text that's exactly what the Lord is trying to point out to Peter. So the Lord shows him this dream of this tablecloth floating down from heaven with all these mixed animals there. You know, Lord, I don't eat pork chops. I'm not allowed to have bacon. I can't eat this. I can't. And the Lord said, "Hey, what I've called clean, you know, you don't call unclean. What I've made clean, you don't call unclean." What Peter had to learn here are a few simple Bible truths that many of us take for granted, but sometimes we don't hear them because we think we know them. The Bible truth is this: all are condemned.
That's right.
Jew and Gentile.
That's right.
All are under condemnation. Romans chapter 3, verse 22, the Bible says, "Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." All are under condemnation. God didn't come to declare our condemnation. Christ didn't come to declare our condemnation at the cross. We're condemned already. Right. He came to provide redemption because we are under condemnation.
Right.
Because of our personal sin. We're born in sin and we sin. We need a Savior. All are under condemnation. God was dealing with Peter's preconceived ideas, his prejudices about the Jewish people and the Gentile people. I'm thankful that not only all are under condemnation, as we know, but all can be saved by faith in Christ. All can be saved by faith in Christ. For there is no difference, Romans 10, 12, and 13 says, "For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved."
Amen.
God, the gospel of grace, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, is available to all who will repent of their sin and receive Jesus Christ as their Savior. All can, anyone can, regardless of nationality, regardless of past history, crimes against the Lord, sins against God, God can save your soul. Christ right. died for your sin. Amen. Christ died for my sin. He had an improper view of the Jewish people relative to the Gentiles. Although the Jews are God's chosen people, the Jews can only be saved the same way the Gentiles can be saved, and that is by repenting of their sin and receiving the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, as their Savior. All are under condemnation. All can be saved by faith. But he also saw this unusual dream. I want to talk to you for a few minutes about this dream. This tablecloth floating down from heaven. That must have been something. I'm old enough to remember some of these cartoons where they had that kind of stuff, you know, in their imagery in these cartoons. And this tablecloth floating down, and you think about it, he's hungry, and so he's got to wonder what in the world's going on here. Is this just an exaggeration of my hunger pains? He saw this assortment of foods that the Jews would not eat. It was part of their traditional, ceremonial law that they couldn't eat these things. But there was a declaration from God three times that God had cleansed these foods. And of course, the point wasn't specifically about Peter's diet. Although I do think God cares about how we take care of our body. The point here was not about his diet, but the point was about his ministry. Peter, I know that you love your people. Peter, I know you have a passion for your own people, for your nation. But Christ died for all.
Amen.
Both Jew and Gentile. And although we look at, and justifiably so, we know this, the Bible bears this out, that Peter's ministry was more specifically to the Jewish people, while Paul's ministry, both of them were Jews, by the way, Paul's ministry was more targeted toward the Gentile people. Both Peter and Paul saw both nationalities come to Christ. If I can say Gentile and a nationality, we understand it's broader than that. But both of them would see and understand that the gospel was available to all. John Phillips, the Bible commenter, said this: Peter had to learn that the ritual law of the Old Testament was no longer binding and that some of his attitudes would have to change.
Right.
That's exactly what took place here. Those ritual laws were changing. Christ is a new and living way. So Peter had been selfish in his view of the Lord's work. Self-will had consumed him. But he became Savior-focused in his view of the Lord. Notice verse 14 with me again. Acts 10, verse 14. But Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." Peter makes here an impossible statement. This is an impossible statement. Look, it is either not so, or he is Lord. It's not so, Lord. That doesn't work.
Amen.
That doesn't work. If he is the Lord, you don't tell him no.
Amen.
When the Lord prompts, you say yes, Lord. Right? Peter makes an oxymoronic claim. Not so, Lord. Lord says, eat. Not so, Lord. Wait a minute. Jesus could have said to him, "Am I the Lord or not?" Right? Not so, Lord, is an impossible statement. You can't have both. It is either not so or it is Lord. All right, let me illustrate this for us. If you got something you can write on, you got something near you there, if you got a pen and a paper, maybe in the back of your bulletin, I want you to write that phrase. If you don't have something to write on, then do it in your brain here, right? Right? Right. Not so, Lord. If you got that written down there, right? You write that out on a piece of paper. Write down, "Not so, Lord." Okay, I'm going to do it myself, all right? Not so, Lord. Okay? So you've got that written down on your piece of paper. You've got your pen, all right? Now here's what you need to do. Cross one or the other out. If you're going to do things your way, listen, then cross Lord out.
That's right.
If you're going to go against the Word of God, in that ever, whatever that specific area is that the Holy Spirit's dealing with you about, then you just go ahead and cross Lord out. Pastor, that'd be sacrilegious. Exactly.
Right.
We think because we don't use pen and paper in our defiance of God, that somehow God doesn't care. God is looking on your heart and mind. God is looking on your heart and mind. He does see our actions,
Amen.
But he's looking on our hearts, right? I hope that you cross out not so. But you know, our lives declare which one is true.
Amen.
But it cannot be not so, Lord. It cannot be not so, Lord. Now, listen, God works at us in varying areas of our life, I think God tests us to see if he truly is our Lord. I remember a time, it's probably been my soul, probably 20 years ago, where God was getting on my case about surrendering to a particular mission field. And I was fighting. You ever been there? I'm like, man, Lord, not been married very long. I think had a couple kids at the time. And man, I'm under some pressure here. And I can sense the pressure. The Lord's saying, I want you to surrender this. I'm like, Lord. I was fighting. I didn't want to do it. Well, finally one morning, I was honest with the Lord. By the way, you might as well be honest with the Lord because he knows what you're thinking.
That's right. Yeah.
I said, Lord, I don't want to go there. Lord, I don't want to take my wife and my kids there. But Lord, if that's what you want me to do, I'm surrendered to you. I'll do what you want me to do. And you want to know what happened? I mean, I didn't hardly get the prayer out in the words in my mind. And it was just, God didn't speak audibly, but I had a peace that came over me. It was just like this. Like, I wasn't going to say anything anyway. I just want to make sure you're surrendered.
Amen.
It's either not so, or it's Lord.
Amen.
It's one or the other. Look, you can't obey, you can't say, I believe all of the Bible and reject part of it. By the way, to reject part of the Bible is to reject it all.
That's right.
Because it's all God's Word.
Amen.
You either believe him or you don't. It's either not so or it's Lord. If he is Lord, then we can only say yes to his commands. And we should.
Amen.
So Peter, he made an impossible statement. John, I want you to consider something else. He became a very improbable spokesman. Peter, down to verse 19. Let's go there. I'll read it and then we'll make some comments. Verse 19. While Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, this is God the Holy Spirit, obviously, behold, three men seek thee. Arise, therefore, and get thee down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. And Peter went down to the men which were sent unto him from Cornelius and said, behold, I am he whom you seek. What is the cause wherefore ye are come? Listen, let's not miss this. Do you see that Peter had changed from not so, Lord, to yes, Lord?
Amen.
He went down and said, I'm the guy you're looking for. Without them saying, we're looking for Peter. Right? Peter transitioned. He had surrendered. Right? Verse 22. And they said, Cornelius, a centurion, a just man, and one that feareth God and of good report among all the nation of the Jews, was warned from God by an holy angel to send for thee into his house to hear words of thee. Then called he them in and lodged them, and on the morrow Peter went away with them, and certain brethren from Joppa accompanied him. And the morrow after they entered into Caesarea, so it took a day to get there, and Cornelius waited for them and had called together his kinsmen and near friends. I mean, he had packed the church house, his house, right, for this meeting. And as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. And Peter took him up and said, stand up, I myself also am a man. And as he talked with him, he went in and found many that were come together. And he said unto them, ye know how that it is unlawful, it is an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or to come into one of another nation. Listen, get this. But God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Where do you see the word man in the preceding portion there of what the Lord told him? But Peter got the lesson.
Amen.
That's exactly what God was teaching him. The gospel is available to all. The gospel is available to all. Loudmouth, lovable, and perhaps even a bit prejudicial, Peter became a preacher to the Gentiles. And many were saved. Skip ahead to verse 43. To him give all the prophets witness that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. He became a great preacher to the Gentiles, and many were saved in Cornelius' house, his home, and those that he influenced, his friends that were gathered, they trusted Christ. Peter, an improbable spokesman. You know, Peter would become the man that God would use to pen perhaps one of the greatest verses of Scripture to oppose what is commonly known as Calvinism today. In 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9, the Bible says this. The Lord chose Peter to pen this. This is the word of God, says this. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is longsuffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
Amen.
God changed the heart of Peter. He became a tremendous spokesman for the fact that the gospel is available to all. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So we've seen Cornelius' view of the Lord. We've seen Peter's view of the Lord. Thirdly, this morning, in closing, what is your view of the Lord? Let's go back where we began. When you hear the word Lord and you think about the Lord, what do you think of? Our self-absorbed culture is so bent and motivated by pointing out and exaggerating the flaws of others that we seldom take time, even with the Word of God, for introspection. Many times we're reading the Word of God so we can be better at dishing it out to somebody else. And we need to allow the Word of God and the Spirit of God to work in our lives.
Right.
What is our view of the Lord? What is your view of the Lord today? How do you view him? Allow the Word of God to examine your own soul. Your soul is the real you. Look, you may put on a front with everybody, with a lot of people. Look, you might as well be honest with God because he knows the real you anyway.
Right.
What is your view of the Lord? Is he your Savior? Can you look to the Lord and go, thank you for being my personal Savior? Has there been a time in your life where you repented of your sin and you received Jesus Christ as your Savior? If not, I plead with you today, trust Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Notice in verse 48 of our text, or Acts chapter 10, verse 48, and he, that pronoun referring to Peter, and he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord, then prayed they him to tarry certain days. So what happened there in verse 48 is the rest of the Great Commission. Peter went as he was supposed to. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. It's exactly what Peter did here with Cornelius, his house in Caesarea, and his friends that were there. He stayed there many days. He showed them, he preached unto them the gospel. Many of them trusted Christ, and it was evidence that because they were filled with the Spirit of God. If you read the whole chapter, you can see that. I'll not take the time this morning. You're welcome. That way your roast won't be overdone, right? To go into all that this in the portion of Scripture. But Peter preached the gospel. Many of them were saved. He said, hey, there's witness, there's evidence that they've received Christ as their Savior. How about we see them baptized?
Amen.
Let's see them make a public profession of their faith by following the Lord in believers' baptism. They've trusted Christ as their Savior. Let's let them make it public. Let's have them baptized. And then they continued. He continued with them. He continued teaching them the truth of God's word. Are we growing in our understanding of the truth of the Lord? What is your view of the Lord? Have you received remission of your sins? Have you believed on him? If not, friend, trust him today. Don't go away without Christ. Don't go away with that emptiness within, knowing that you're bearing your sin burden when Christ wants to take that burden from you. If you've received Christ as your Savior, have you made that personal faith public? by following the Lord in believer's baptism. By the way, scripturally, that is baptism by immersion in water, identifying with the death of Jesus on the cross, his burial, and his resurrection, raised to walk in the newness of life. And it is also done under the authority of the local New Testament church.
Right.
Two church ordinances, two responsibilities that the Lord gave to the church. One was baptism, the other was the Lord's Supper. Have you followed the Lord in believer's baptism? And are you presently following the Lord? Is it not so, or is it Lord? Is he your Lord? Are you following the Lord today? Perhaps you find yourself wrestling with him. In effect, you are trying to make an impossible statement to God. The same one that Peter tried to make. Not so, Lord! I can't do that. Why not? He is the Lord of all.
Amen.
Trust him. I plead with you today to cross out the not so and to renew, to underline, to circle, to highlight, Lord, in your life. Father, thank you for our time together in your word today. We thank you for this text, how you used it in these men's lives. Lord, I trust you've used it in our lives today. Holy Spirit, I pray you continue your work in each of our hearts and lives according to your desired will. Lord, help us to let you be the Lord. Or if there be any among us today that don't know you as their personal Lord, I pray today they'd trust you. Others, Lord, who have trusted you as Savior but need to take this next step of faith in their life, whether it be baptism, church membership, or another area of our living for you, enjoying this life, the life you intended for us to enjoy abundantly as we follow your word. Lord, help us to say yes, Lord, and to stop trying to say not so, Lord. Help us to love you more. And as we think of your name, we think of the Lord, that the words that would come to our mind would be loving, Savior, mighty God, wonderful, truly awesome. And we would not tend to think about judgment, your omniscience, that you know things about us that we wish were not so. Lord, help us to allow you to be the Lord of our lives afresh and anew today. Thank you for our time in your word. Do your work in this invitation time, we ask, in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Let's stand together, shall we?